Hello and welcome to part 2 of 5 of the introduction to the London Naval Treaty of 1930, the joint project with me and Dan Freeman. So I hope you enjoy it, and I'm now going to change back to the configuration I do these videos in. Oh, and before I forget, if you do like these videos, please do like and subscribe down below and press the bell. Also, if you want to see more of Dan's videos, there will be a link down in the description. Thank you.
So, Article 8 is now next one. And Article 8 is my favourite article. And people will have heard about Article 8 before for a reason. And you'll work out the moment you hear it if you don't remember it. Subject to any special agreements which may submit them to limitation, the following vessels are exempt from limitation. Any naval service combatant vessel of 610 metric tons, standard displacement and under. Naval service combatant vessel exceeding 600 tons, 610 metric tons, but not exceeding 2,000 tons, 2,032 metric tons, sound displacement, provided they have none of the following characteristics. 1. Mount a gun above a 6.1 inch, 155 millimeter caliber. 2. Mount more than 4 guns above 3 inch, 76 millimeter caliber. 3. Are designed or fitted to launch torpedoes. 4. Are designed for a speed greater than 20 knots. The emphasis being on the phrase is designed. Designed in those ones. And then C, naval service vessels not specifically built as fighting ships, which are employed on fleet duties or as troop defense transports or in some other way than as fighting ships, provided they have none of the characteristics. 1. Mount a gun above 6.1 inch, 155 millimeter caliber. 2. Mount more than 4 guns above 3 inch, 76 millimeter caliber. 3. Are designed or fitted to launch torpedoes. 4. Are designed for a speed greater than 20 knots. 5. Are designed protected by armor plate. 6. Are designed or fitted to launch mines. 7. Are fitted to receive aircraft on board from the air. 8. Mount more than 1 aircraft launching apparatus on the center line, or 2, one on each broadside. 9. If fitted with any means of launching aircraft in the air, are designed or adapted to operate at sea more than 3 aircraft. I love Article 8 because that is what gives rise to the sloop and various other things as well, but also the motor torpedo boat and all these things. They're fun.
Yeah. That's because, just going through, and actually it's worth rewinding to the aircraft carrier thing, that the reason aircraft carriers were banned from having anything bigger than 6-inch guns is to avoid anyone going, look, it's got a flight deck. Points at something about the size of an A4 piece of paper, mm-hmm. and it's covered in 8-inch guns to basically just build cruisers with their allocation.
Yeah, that is part of the thing. And also, it's nice if you're doing that with the weightation of an aircraft carrier, you could build a jolly good cruiser.
You could build a very jolly good cruiser compared with the 10,000 tonners, and you can fit, 8 or 10 8-inch guns on the thing, and as many 6-inch guns as you can squeeze onto it.
Or you could build a half-hearted, halfway house, like the Americans were sometimes considering, of half cruiser, half carrier.
Yeah. It's every American's, you know, Second Amendment right to have 9 6-inch guns and 8 5-inch guns on their aircraft carrier that's designed to carry 24 aircraft in 10,000 tons standard displacement, capable of doing 32.5 knots. And in no way will it have the same kind of level of armor protection as I believe the Chinook has, which is something along the lines of you can push a pencil through it skin.
A very, very blunt pencil.
Don't get me wrong, I love the Chinook. I have friends who've gone to war in the Chinook. Chinook is wonderful.
Yes. Same here. I have done many random things in a Chinook in my time. But leaving that all to one side, the fact is, the interesting thing is, again, they're obsessed with, people might think, listening to Trini, why are they so obsessed with 6.1 inch caliber? Basically, that is the level at which ships start counting as cruisers and start counting as very dangerous ships. If you're talking to the Royal Navy, also that doesn't bother them, because when they're talking about destroyers, they're talking about something with a 4.7-inch gun. Or if they're talking about sloops, they're going to have a 4-inch gun. It really doesn't worry them that much, because they're going for rate of fire and capability. This is actually a big thing to push down on the smaller powers, which are seeking to turn their destroyers and their sloop equivalents into basically small cruisers by putting on as powerful a guns as they can. In fact, some navies start really looking quite hard into developing 5.9-inch guns and all these sort of things. And you sit there and go, okay, that's pushing the treaty. And if we consider the World War II performance of the German destroyers and these things, this is where this comes from. The idea that you can make your... And it's the interesting thing, because this is the sort of the treaty which also starts to produce the tribal class destroyers and all the super destroyers, destroyer leaders. And the ways it goes about and the way nations go about it, some are putting on as close to cruiser caliber guns as they can possibly fit. Others are going, hang on, I want guns, but do I need it? Does that, what is the advantage relative of that versus that? And you start to see very much a status race in many respects, which some nations choose to get involved in, and some literally go, why?
There's a good bit in Jordan's Warships After London book about when talking about the decisions made about the post-London treaty, US destroyers, when they're trying to... The 5-inch 25, short, nippy, not the same penetrating power, not the same accuracy as the 5-inch 50 or 51 caliber. And then the Bureau of Ordnance just comes on and goes, oh, we were thinking of making a 5-inch 38. And they go, yes, please. And the reason for that was because the Royal Navy and US Navy... Again, this is according to Jordan, so I'm kind of quoting him in effect for his message. Basically recognize that a destroyer is a small little thing that bobs around a lot, is moving fast. Using it as a high accuracy, long range gunnery platform is not a good use of things. So actually what you need is rate of fire, ability to shift fire quickly of the guns, hence actually single mounts not necessarily being that much worse than twin mounts, because actually with something that, like, what you're doing is you're just kind of having the men shove it round rather than power operated centrally controlled gunnery. It's just not worth it. You have local control, just shoot as much as you can, and let's say you have a 5% hit rate. Okay, that's one shell in 20. But if you can get off 20 shells in 2 minutes, you know, you're getting a hit every 2 minutes, which compared to the battleship that's going to struggle to get off 4 salvos in that time,
yeah,
long range, and you're just going to sit there and dodge. And that's the idea, that you're kind of going to weave forward. You're going to be shooting up the enemy's destroyers with your rapid fire guns, and they're going to be going crazy fast as well. Whilst you stop them from getting close enough to your capital ships for them to launch torpedoes, or you get close enough to their capital ships to launch torpedoes, which are your big ship threatening weapon. They're your equalizer. Yeah. They're the
It's one of the interesting things. It's sort of when you're talking about some of the discussions that are born within the Royal Navy and the US Navy at this time, when they're looking at the French and the Italian navies and the German navies, when they're sort of putting these big guns on their destroyers, they're sort of looking and going, well, A, how are you going to stabilize these guns to actually make them accurate? We have to consider, you presume you are going to, but we're not really sure how you're going to do it. And two, this ship is about destroyers. Their anti-ship capability in terms of their anti-big ship capability is their torpedo.
Yeah.
If you start forgetting that and start trying to treat them as a small cruiser, you're forgetting the entire advantages of their hull. And that's the interesting thing with the US Navy and the Japanese navies, of course. Their super destroyers are very incredibly torpedo-focused. And then the Royal Navy's ones are destroyer gun-focused in terms of their guns, but they still have the torpedoes as their big hitting weapon. And yeah, it's sort of gone for volume of fire over the long-range fire. But it's sort of the Royal Navy one is, in a way, is sort of a halfway house between some of the European ideas and some of the American and Japanese ideas, in that it's gone, we are going for a gunnery armament, but we're not going for a massive gunnery armament. We're going for the guns being good destroyer guns, but more of them.
Yeah. And we're recognising that they're destroyer guns, and for reasons, I mean, both the French and the Italians are building these somewhere between very large destroyers and very small cruiser designs that are pretty much perfect, I think, for the Mediterranean, and I wouldn't want to take anywhere else, really.
Yes.
Possibly the Persian Gulf, but that wasn't really a war zone at this point.
It has some fun times. It does have some fun times. But honestly, there's the whole point of getting them round to the Persian Gulf, which is the bit of the problem I must sort of be a bit worried about, because just about getting through the Red Sea, but then I'd have to go into a little bit of the Indian Ocean, and frankly, in the Arabian Sea, and I'd be... the waves there might get a little bit high.
Yeah.
I'd be going very fast and praying for a calm day.
Yeah. And the other thing it's worth saying, and this also plays into the Royal Navy's post-London Naval Treaty, can we say passion, love affair with the 6-inch gun?
Oh, it's a beautiful weapon. It's a beautiful thing. The 6-inch gun, it's just, you know, it is our Lord and Saviour. It is the 6-inch gun. It's glorious. It is.
Well, it recognises the reality that to take on another cruiser, you need a 6-inch gun. An 8-inch gun is actually overkill, because what everyone is sacrificing at this point, and the Royal Navy are possibly the least worst at this, it feels like, is armour.
The Royal Navy can afford to be the least worst at it because they are using the lighter turrets, aka the 6-inch guns.
Yes.
Yeah.
Even their 8-inch designs have actually got a vague recognition that that armour might be a thing instead of doing the Japanese.
To be fair, we're also talking about 8-inch guns, the first generation of which can go up to fire up to 70 degrees up in the air, angled, and can be used for anti-aircraft, and were used for anti-aircraft role during World War II. So we cannot really claim sanity of 8-inch design was strong in the Royal Navy. And then to build a lighter, they decided they were going to build a lighter gun, a Mark II, which would take away that capability, and the turret actually came out heavier. It could swivel faster, though, and that was the fun thing. It was like you didn't want to get away in the turret. It was one of the fastest moving 8-inch turrets known at the time. It would literally go, zoom, hello, we're pointing towards you now. Oh, great. How did that happen?
I mean, that has an advantage if you're going to play the small, fast, nippy type role, zipping round, nimble. Because if you're zigzagging, especially if you're pulling away from somebody, you want to be able to shoot over your shoulder, don't you? Whilst you're running away, having launched your torpedoes at them.
That is the entire design for the battle class, because if you don't have guns on the back, you basically have to have your guns as far forward as you can so that they can fire over your back.
Yeah. And as anyone who plays World of Warships knows, getting your turrets to go from left to right, from sort of most of the way back left to most of the way back right, takes a frickin' age in anything.
There is a reason why whenever I play a battleship in that game, I always sort of I tend to pre-chart my course and try and make sure the enemy are always going to come at me from the same side, so I don't have to turn my guns around.
Yeah. Well, what my two of my favourite battleships in that are Warspite and Nelson, and they do not turn their turrets very quickly.
No, but Nelson, you can just point yourself at them.
Yes, I do.
Admittedly, it takes out a third. It takes out a third of your armament, but it does make you a far smaller picture to take on. Yeah. Anyway, Article 9.
Yeah.
Article 9 is the rules of as a replacement combined in Annex 1 to this Part 2 are applicable to vessels of war not exceeding 10,000 tons, 10,160 metric tons, standard displacement, with the exception of aircraft carriers, whose replacement is governed by the provisions of the Washington Treaty.
Yeah.
Shall this we do Annex 1 now, or shall we do leave Annex 1 till we get to the end? Let's do leave Annex 1 for a bit.
Yeah. I mean, that's just the kind of replacement schedules that sets out that you can't just bin your entire current fleet and build something new that's optimized to fit within the rules.
Yeah.
But it means that no one else can do it, so you're not going to have to suddenly try and find the budget to do that.
Yep. If everyone's following the rules, of course.
Yeah. That's one area where I think it would be hard for somebody to break the rules. You can build a ship and go, no, really, wait, look, it weighs 6,000 tons standard displacement. Really? Yeah. That looks suspiciously like 10,000 tons standard displacement. No, totally not. No, look, we made it out of balsa wood, not steel, honest. But actually having a ship? I mean, unless you're going to turn around and go, no, we refitted it. Really? That HMS, let's make up a name.
Iron Duke looks rather suspiciously like a King George the Fourth now.
Yes. What's with the, you've got two triple turrets at the front and one at the back. I'm fairly sure you have, and they look suspiciously like 15-inch guns. I'm fairly sure you had five twin turrets mounting 13.5-inch guns. Also, I'm pretty sure I just clocked you going at about nearly 30 knots when you were a 21-knot vessel.
We were only doing 30 knots. Have the chief stoker shot.
We were practicing cruising speed, seeing how efficient we could get for getting to the Far East.
Yeah,
with the single lane. Yeah.
Sorry, if I rebuild a battleship of that size down to that, then I'm wanting 40. Yeah, it's all there, but it goes further because, you know, it's not just Article 9, it's Article 10.
Yep.
Within 1 month after the date of laying down and the date of completion...
I'm going to try and grab a spare beer because I've dropped my London Pride and didn't want to get the others out of the fridge, but you keep talking.
Go.
I have at least friendlies.
That's good. Article 10. Within 1 month after the date of laying down and the date of completion, respectively, of each vessel of war, other than capital ships, aircraft carriers, and the vessels exempt from limitation of Article 8, laid down or completed by or for them after the coming into force of the present treaty, the high contracting party shall communicate to each of the other high contracting parties the information detailed below. The date of laying and the keel and the following particulars, classification of the vessel, sound displacement in tons and metric tons, principal dimensions, namely length at waterline, extreme beam at or below waterline, mean draft at standard displacement, caliber of the largest gun. B, the date of the completion, together with foregoing particulars relating to the vessel of the state, and the information to be given in the case of capital ships and aircraft carriers is governed by the Washington Treaty. It's a fun thing. I often wonder if this is an attempt to try and make naval intelligence be able to be cut, or you can just buy a copy of Jane's and find out. But what I find funny is the whole way through, there is a belief that people actually be... There is theoretically a belief that people actually be honest and they're revealing this information. But then when you read the archives and you read the data, actually they are presuming everyone will be dishonest. Just they'll be within a margin of latitude of dishonesty because they can't cover it up too much because your own naval architects can do some sums and look at pictures and work figure some things out. So
steel has a certain degree of density, and by knowing three dimensions, you can work out that... oh, by the way, which one do you think is more appropriate for now? Old Empire or Spitfire?
Old Empire, right? We haven't got to the... we've got past the aircraft carriers. If you want to try Spitfire, you can.
Oh, no, I know I like Spitfire. I can't remember about Old Empire. Okay, I'm not sure I've had it before. I know I like Spitfire.
Right, so...
sorry, I always have
It's a fun thing, this treaty. You start to realise this is governing quite a lot of things that we deal with in World War II. And people look at it and go, I don't understand why there was this. Well, actually, you can go back and they just didn't have time to fix it.
Yeah, pretty much. There's a lot that... I mean, this does have a huge impact. And my... In coming up with what-ifs... Like I said, what-ifs are my... Counterfactual stuff is my thing. I think I'm going to call them counterfactual, not alternate history, because counterfactual is when you kind of just look at a single point and then and only really go one step on and explore all the possibilities rather than taking one idea and pursuing it, which is much better put by Dr. Kat on her thing, on her videos. She, I think, is a historian who doesn't clash with you but does a lot of stuff. I don't know if you've come across her stuff.
I haven't looked at it yet, but if I do find it, I will enjoy it.
It's really good, and she's got a lovely thing about that exact thing, exact idea, in about 12 minutes. That just really beautifully encapsulates it and comes up with some nice examples and things. Anyway, I think this pushed back a Pacific war by about 4 years. I think that had things stuck with the Washington Naval Treaty and there'd not been any modifications, I think that the Imperial Japanese Navy would have felt that they would not have... they would have been so worried that America was going to start pulling away from them by kind of the very late 30s, early 40s, unrestrained, that they would have, if they ever wanted to strike the US, they would have done it in 37 or 38. And I chose those years because, A, they invaded the rest of China in 37, and B, you know, so I could see them doing it as part of that kind of set of attacks and things. So the Navy goes one way, the Army goes the other, and it's to stop the Americans from interfering with them, taking China. And the other reason being that that's when the fleet problems took the entire US fleet towards Hawaii and Midway. So the Americans are putting themselves all together and collecting themselves together. And if they get a message of something, we're under attack, on the radio, is it an exercise? Is it the Imperial Japanese Navy using 24-inch torpedoes to go, hello?
It's always a possibility. Either way, it will work.
Yeah. But yeah, so that's my kind of what-if war, is I think it would have led to a Japanese strike on the kind of combined US fleet, really, in the Pacific in either 37 or 38, probably combined with pushing the start of the Second Sino-Japanese War back.
I think the Royal Navy would have ended up dragged into that, but probably would have been quite a little bit happier with it than what happened in World War II.
Yeah, that's my thought, and I think the Japanese would not have expected that, because I think the Japanese thought that... I think they viewed Britain as kind of a peer. You know, you're an island with various mountains. You know, you've got these traditions. I think they saw a lot of similarities and thought the British did as well. And I don't think the British did.
Now.
Sorry, this is getting on to hypotheticals and moving away from our treaty.
So I hope you enjoyed that. That's part two of five. And as said, if you like, please do subscribe and share and press the little bell down there. And there's a link to Dan's YouTube in the description. Thank you very much. Thank you. Take care.